had the freeze ray? reactor. The first two are in the room itself, but the third is in a storage room nearby, where we get to control an RC car from a distance in a separate room. We need to knock the cell onto the floor and out through a hole in the wall. This is hard to accomplish. Your viewing angle is from Duke's location outside, and the controls are oriented to wherever the car's facing. The controls suck.
This guy, almost there. Wait, wait. Oh, damn it.
Grab the cell, charge the reactor, access the mounted cannon, take out the alien mothership. We notice something interesting here. If you do nothing, the mothership will just sit there waiting for you to fire on it. The whole game pauses until Duke shoots first. Apparently, if Duke just does nothing, the game, the invasion, everything could end immediately. So, self-control, Duke. Self-control.
What did you say? Shoot a hole.
Damn it, man! That must have been some explosion to knock the Dukester out cold.
When Duke wakes up, he crawls through loads of vents and eventually makes his way back into the hotel.
Oh my god, Duke!
We're not that far into the game, but boy, we've seen a lot of vents.
Move out to Vegas, do a few aliens, toss a few crabs. Double entendre. I think that's French for I play with my own shit.
Around the corner, we run into a shrink trap. Remember these from Duke 3D? Duke gets fun-sized and travels around like a mouse. Usually, this opens up new exploration possibilities, but in Duke Forever, it's just,
we eventually end up with a young boy, the boy's mother, and more importantly, the boy's RC car. Time for the game's first driving section.
Unfortunately, the physics make driving a complete mess. Turning is slow, which makes lining up the car for jumps super tedious. Worse, when your aim's off, the car slams into a wall and you need to back up and readjust to progress.
It's annoying as you go through various jumps through the hotel. It gets worse later on in the game, but we'll get to that later.
Continuing through more hallways and convenient jumps, we take one last boosted leap before crashing the RC car.
We meet up with an Earth Defense Force soldier.
No relation.
And the Shoeshine Twins.
Yes, relations.
They have a particle expander that can restore Duke to normal size. Great, and just in time for combat. In a room with no cover to hide behind.
How are we supposed to keep recovering health without a place to cover?
Who knows? Both of the enemies have the high ground, so you really just have to suck it up and
when enough foes are slaughtered, two aliens teleport in to swipe the twins. It's a scripted event that can't be altered.
Not my babes. Not in my town. You aliens. Are gonna pay for this.
With no way forward, we head back. Besides, this gamer uses levels like a carpenter with short-term memory loss. Think about it. Like a bubble level?
I still don't get it.
Here, a series of pig cops come charging down the hallway with horrific AI. Their strategy seems to be hurling their bodies at our bullets.
We meet up with the general who informs us that the aliens have occupied the Hoover Dam and are using its power to create a wormhole in the sky.
The aliens have gigantic spaceships capable of interstellar travel, teleportation devices, shrink traps, but the only way they can open a wormhole is with a dam we humans built in the 30s? Okay.
But the dam power siphoning isn't Duke's biggest problem.
They're taking our wind, Duke.
Up getting killed, to which Duke responds,
yeah, this job.
sausage. We get puzzles. Like jump across some water that's occasionally electrified and shoot the fire extinguisher on a hanging dead body to put out some fire. Just like the house system and gun limits, they're clearly borrowing these puzzle mechanics from other games. Remember the Half-Life seesaw puzzle earlier? Not a coincidence. Valve-style puzzles show up a lot here, including a seesaw fetch quest. Here, we need to collect a bunch of oil barrels from the nearby area and dump them in a rocking shipping container to reach the ledge and move on. That's Half-Life 2, only with none of Valve's gameplay philosophy or charm. We burn a path to the Duke Dome. As we traverse, we come across alien jump pads, which seem like they would only benefit Duke Nukem, the man coming to kill every one of them. We bounce around like a moron and find Duke's favorite pair of boot polishers. It doesn't go well. Oh, what happened? What's under the black box? Have you ever seen the movie Alien? Yeah. That's what happened. Graphic. I feel like we should have a moment of silence or something. Hey, wanna slap some wall boobs?
Strange silicone-based life form.
Chick-less. Duke bounces through an explosive puzzle and makes it to a boss. A giant mama alien called Queen Bit. How do we put this? Someone watched Total Recall. You blow her up with a mixture of pipe bombs and bounce pads, all while questioning how a race of aliens that clearly spawned from eggs requires a queen alien with three mammary glands. You do the deed and are met with a nice big explosion. It knocks Duke backwards. Duke stays into unconsciousness while an engineer runs over to help. Duke is once again knocked out, and we dive into his subconscious in Duke Nukem's Titty City. Duke is in a coma, I guess, and inside his mind there's a strip club. Duke is tasked by his dream exotic dancer to find a bag of popcorn, a strangely shaped back massager, and a tubular balloon. For once, the game gives us absolutely no direction as to where to find anything. It's literally what we wanted the whole game. Free exploration. Run around all over the place and find what you need. Interact with everything, see? So why isn't it fun? Because they missed what made Duke 3D's exploration good. In the past, you had to look for a single item at a time, like, say, a key card. You'd find one that would let you progress to the next area. It was near instant gratification. And this? Unfortunately, it feels like it doesn't matter. It's a dream, narratively useless. It just serves to show how vapid Duke's mind really is. Maybe it's supposed to be funny? Are we supposed to enjoy the fact that Duke seems brain dead? Once we finish our fetch quest, we head upstairs and talk to the stripper. She gives us a lap dance, and then we wake up inside a chopper with an EDF soldier working a mounted gun in front of us. We learn that the president is blaming Duke for the alien attack.
You missed a lot. The president's claiming you attacked the aliens first.
Which we didn't. Aliens were already attacking everything and everyone. The chopper is hit, and we crash into the Duke Burger Tower, where we get a fun level glitch. There should be a scripted event that causes a piece of concrete to fall here, giving us a path forward. This never happened. We didn't realize this until we tried to make an impossible jump. Upon redoing the encounter, the concrete fell correctly this time. Glitches and visual sloppiness abound. An alien with a jetpack thinks it's a good idea to drag Duke up into the sky, probably to drop him from a great height. Jamie doesn't count on Duke punching his head off. Or at least I assume that's what happens. They never animated the head coming off. We just punch in and it disappears. But what comes next is a heavy contender for the worst part of this entire game, the Duke Burger Kitchen. I hate this place so much. Up until this point, we've kind of glossed over platforming in this game, but here, we gotta get into it. The kitchen is flooded. Not only that, it's electrified. You can travel sized again and need to hop around the entire kitchen, jumping off of ovens and burners that are scorching. All the while, enemies spawn in, trying to shoot you. If you make a wrong move, you either burn your beaten hot grease, or fall butt first into soon-to-be electrified water. All this while a stupid employee stuck in the middle of the room won't stop talking.
He's so confused. Small like that.
I just want to put him in a burger and eat him up.
But eventually, we made it through and turned off the power. The employee thanks us by opening the door to another bathroom with, oh good, another vent we climbed through.
Vents. What is with this game and vents? The only thing that has more airflow is the breeze passing between Duke's ears.
shake things up. It can't just keep repeating itself.
Well, you're not in luck, because here is another huge truck sequence. Well, the truck is life-sized.
The Mighty Foot is a truck covered in fake sponsored ads from companies like Fasting Gas Company, Booty Incorporated, Group Ship Industries. It's perfect. The truck has crap advertising and handles like it too.
Driving is just as bad as ever. Last time we were behind the wheel, mishaps only seemed to occur when dealing with jumps, and there weren't that many. The rest of the space was flat. But here, there's absolutely no flat space to be found.
One wrong move and the truck flings out from level geometry. It's impossible to control. So we came up with a strategy for this action-packed sequence.
Yeah, a little slower than my grandpa through a Wendy's drive-thru.
But they had to make it worse. So they throw in another mechanic, a diminishing fuel reserve. What a great idea. Make the driving unbearable and then give the player freaking gasoline fetch quests.
After we find the gas, it's back to more jumping off concrete and driving through lazily similar design levels until the truck magically runs out of gas again. Oh, welcome to Ghost Town.
Sure, this town seems fine at first, but look close enough and the buildings are completely empty, devoid of anything of interest.
We fight enemies, do a physics puzzle, get a gas canister. Then back into the driver's seat. That whole section was just for that?
Yup. Then we run out of gas again and hunt for more minutes later. Are they serious?
Another location. This time we get to ride a minecart. The linear game design has evolved into a literal on-rails experience.
Take in this pointless time filler, and the last mine cart takes you directly back to your truck. I mean, if you have to do some backtracking, it's better to have actual track to help you, am I right?
With the truck filled up once again, we drive the thing into the water outside the dam, where it promptly despawns. Tell me up more gasoline now, you
And we get topside, and go face to face with the president himself, who berates us for getting involved. For him to be evac'd away. At least, maybe, that was supposed to happen.
If you keep watching the president and his agents, they run to the dropship and just stand there. The game waits until you've walked away to actually remove the characters from the level. Guess they wanted to save on animating them getting into the chopper.
Also, at some point during the years, the devs clearly played GoldenEye, so they did a whole jump off the dam with a bungee cord sequence. Go on and add 007 to the clown car we talked about earlier.
Get in the car, James.
Then we get the freeze ray, but as you'd probably expect, it's not so cool.
In Duke 3D, you had the freeze thrower, which shot projectiles that dealt instant damage to your foes or even freeze them solid.
The freeze ray is an ice beam that you have to aim at enemies for a long time to freeze them, and then they're not even dead. You still have to walk up to them and execute them while avoiding attacks from other aliens.
This is against enemies that normally only take one or two hits with a regular weapon. Why go through the hassle of freezing them?
Toss the freeze ray as soon as you can. Just not for the RPG. Close quarters levels like this are apparently not meant for explosives.
These weapons limitations are infuriating. Would be real great to have access to all your weapons at once.
Right? Once we clear the area, a dam technician lets us continue on. Continue to what? Valve puzzles.
I hate valve puzzles.
Oh, good. They're making fun of Half-Life now. Turn the valves to spray alien obstacles with acid to dissolve them.
I guess you could say we're fed up with these puzzles.
Yeah. Once outside, we're met with this confusing scene.
There's a bug out there, too. I'll break the door. Oh, my God! It's happening!
Looks like the guy's lower half is being eaten, but when we pick up the sliding door, he looks fine.
Until it drops the door on him. Boosh. Great job!
Now we get to drive a forklift. Surprisingly, this thing actually works.
And it's kind of fun. We ride down the nicely spaced and roomy hallways with enough warning to turn into our enemies and mow them down.
But just like that, it was over.
30 seconds of actual gameplay? Really? That's all they could give us?
There's no time. We need to get to the next achingly bad section, which happens to be everyone's favorite element-based level.
Oh, no.
An underwater section.
In this game? Are you serious?
Not fun. The whole area is submerged, and you don't have a breathing device like the scuba gear in Duke Nukem 3D. You'll need to reach air bubbles that come up from the ground, Sonic style, to refill your oxygen.
Submerged, you have to interact with all solving, obstacles, and plenty of enemies to shoot.
Getting the hang of it? Oh good, here's an underwater boss battle.
This tentacle freak is only damaged by rockets, so you're constantly searching for ammo, while also searching for oxygen, while also dodging the boss's attacks. We made sushi with him by the skin of our teeth.
We set charges to blow the dam. We escaped by running across a spiral staircase with explosive
arrows
flying at us.
I was expecting a monkey.
Cool, Donkey Kong.
Make it through, and you get a nice view of the dam breaking apart. Duke passes out again.
He needs more than a shocked aristocrat finding they're out of Grey Poupon.
Poor old Duke awakens from a soldier performing CPR. An angry president waits nearby who informs us that he was going to use the aliens for his own benefit.
The whole world,
you idiot! It would have gotten away with it too if Mr. Newcomb hadn't interfered.
Instead of killing Duke while he was unconscious, he waits for him to wake up so he can dramatically make a command over the radio.
Cataclysm!
Nuke being dropped on Duke.
Poetic. Think you can clip the press here? Nah, you can't. It's all scripted. Just like it's scripted that the Emperor will show up at this precise moment and deal with the president for us. Gee, thanks!
Time for the final battle. One last long ammo-hunting, minion-killing smorgasbord.
Every time you empty the health gauge on the Emperor, you run up and spam buttons to knock out some of his equipment only to do it again. Tedious, but not complicated.
After your final bout, the Emperor falls. Duke takes a moment while enemies are still firing on him to pee in the Emperor's eye before making a run for the dropship.
Wee-wee! The general grabs hold as the ship takes off, moments away from the arrival of the president's nuke. The dropship spins out of control, and the screen goes black.
But don't worry, Duke's not dead.
We get a press conference where Duke, alive and well, says he now plans to run for president.
There's a strip joint that lives in my bed.
Sure. Okay, great. There's some DLC that takes place after this, but really, after playing this, would you want to play more?
This game is a prime example of what happens when there are too many cooks in the kitchen.
What's most disappointing? The exciting 2001 E3 demo was actually playable with a lot of it done, according to developers who worked on the project. That's the game we wanted. Heck, we still want.